budget process. The format for today is we're going to start with committees of council, go to community grants, then backtrack through capital operating to the summary. And then we'll have all the elements of the budget, and all the adjustments will result in what we finally come out with. And the process, we hope, will be done before 2 o'clock this afternoon, and we'll move forward from there. But before we get started, I just want to ask council if they individually or collectively have any items that, housekeeping items that we should clear up. Deputy Mayor?
A few things. Number one, I think you missed donations as well. We need to look at the donation sheet as well.
Yes.
Okay. All right. I'm going to pass on some information, and I'm hoping that at some point in time, sooner or later, someone from Rural Representation will appear today. Yesterday on their Facebook page, and at this point I'd like to call upon Councillor Politnik if he could read the information that was posted on the Rural Representation Facebook page, and I'd like to respond to that.
Flash. The MPH preliminary budget for 2018 includes $450,000 to improve 7 roads in the urban ward, $505,000 for renovations of the Garden Hill Fire Station, including library space, hiring of an additional road staff member allocated to the rural ward, and a project to evaluate MPH communications to the rural ward. More details in our December 17th newsletter. Make sure you are a member to receive an email to info@ruralrepresentative.com.
Thank you. I received a copy of this from a rural resident who was concerned that there was some misrepresentation of what occurred on Monday related to our discussions about the capital budget, et cetera, et cetera. And I'd just like to take a moment to put it out there exactly what we accomplished, and if I'm wrong, someone can tell me so. But in their Facebook page, they indicated that the $450,000 was set aside for 7 roads in the urban area. That is incorrect. It was in the rural area. Station number 3, $505,000 in upgrades and renovation to the station. They indicated that that also included the public library. That, in fact, is not the case. What we did talk in terms of is that we would be able to set aside approximately $20,000 potentially in the library budget that would go to do some renovations at the Canton Municipal Office if, in fact, the decision of the library board was that they would move there, seeing as how the existing space at the fire station number 3 is now taken up with the upgrades for the fire station. The other comment that was made, and they did indicate an extra road, I believe, road supervisor, but I'd like to go through and just list those areas. We, in the rural area, we've also got the Welcome Water Initiative, $200,000 that's being paid for by the Ministry of Transportation. The rural library, I've already covered off, there's $20,000 that could be set aside in the library budget to improve the situation at the Canton Municipal Office if they decide to go that route. A rural snowplow for $275,000. Commercial gear washers and dryers, each station $15,000, so that's a total of $30,000 for stations 2 and 3 in the rural area. The storage dome roof at $75,000 to do roof repairs to it. Auto extraction rescue equipment at all 3 stations, so that basically is about $84,000. 3/4-ton 4x4 station number 3, $45,000. Dry hydrant construction, 5th line and 28, for $2,500 is contained in the operating budget of fire and emergency services. The bridges and embankment guide rails and improvements, a total of $50,000. One staff person of the rural roads, and I wasn't sure what that total was, I estimated around $60,000 to $70,000. Additional water reservoir at number 10, the capital budget for $20,000. That total is $1,686,500 plus the $200,000 for the Welcome Water. If you just take the welcome water out, because it's being funded by the provincial government, that's a total of $1,686,500. And I believe I'm correct in saying, and please correct me if I'm wrong, that only 19% of that is actually being paid by the rural residents. So we're only looking at a bill in the rural area of $320,435, give or take, for all of that work. And I want that to go on the record, and I'm hoping that rural representation will revise their commentary, especially when they put the information out to the public in their December newsletter. Please get the facts straight. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other general comments from the council? Okay, then let's... Go.
I mentioned to you just a little bit earlier, and I just put it to staff, David and staff, in the car allowance area for council, there is a total of $5,400, which represents six times $900 per person. But it's my understanding that when we did that remuneration, we added an extra $900 to both of the rural councillors. I indicated to staff that I did not want to take that extra $900. So what I'd like to see is that we revise that car allowance up another $900 to, I think it's $6,300 or whatever, $6,200, whatever it comes to. It's just that I think we missed that in our deliberation. Thank you.
Okay, so duly noted, and we will proceed with the next part. Our presentation, committees of council. Okay. All right, and who's doing this part? I am, right? Okay, so as in front of you and on the screen is the six committees of council, and the requests, last year's, and the variances. Any comments? Councilor Plutnik?
I know I'm going to go to hell for this one, but I'm confused. Under accessibility, where they're requesting $2,400, but they get one third of the parking revenue. Why do they need both?
Councilor Hickey?
The $2,400 is for what the committee itself is doing, functioning as a committee. The money that they get from the parking fees, these are monies that are put into reserve and oftentimes used by various departments, particularly Parks and Recreation, to assist in funding of different projects. So there are two different amounts of money. The $24 is for committee purposes. It could be for education. It could be for travel. It could be for whatever committees do. So it's a very different thing from the other.
I understand that, but a couple of years ago they had $97,000 in their reserve that hadn't been utilized, and Works took some of it to fix sidewalks and to cut down. I'm just, they do have a revenue stream. I mean, $2,400 is not a whole lot of money, and I really don't care, but it's just Councilor Lee says something.
Well, like Councilor Higgy said, there's members of the committee that have special invoices and care to be able to get to the meetings and stuff, and I think that's a lot of this money is used for that as well, caregivers and things that they need to attend the meetings and travel, and but Councilor Hickey said it's travel, it's all those expenses that's covered by the committee for those members for accessibility to get to the meetings and take part in all the sessions and stuff. And that's what this is covered for. They submit bills for expenses and stuff for members to get to the meetings, and it's all covered by that. It's for special accessibility. And like you said, the other money is for projects. It's totally different. This is expenses that are taken or used for to run the committee to do the business that they do. And then the other reserve is all projects. It's all things that Parks and Rec did, accessibility around the band shell, all those kind of projects are from that other reserve. It's two different things. Thank you for clarifying. You're welcome.
Are you suggesting that we lump it all together, like every other part of the organization, They have one pot of money, they draw everything out of that pot, whether it be for projects or administration.
Well, no, it's just that all of the other committees, they do have secretarial fees and all of the other things that are there. I'm not seeing those coming up in the, this. It's just, this is one group that does have a revenue stream that just seems strange that they were coming for. They would give me a right explanation that I can live with. I mean, it's $2,400. It's not a big enough thing. I just wondered why it was there.
If it was up to me, I'd lump it all together, and they'd have one pot to draw on and submit the expenses as they are. Well, I don't know, everybody's shaking their head, but go ahead.
Just a couple things. Under the budgets submitted, there is no line there for the Center of Excellence. There was a report that was attached to that whole section under Committees of Council that referred to a motion put forward by the Center of Excellence working group. And I'll just read, I won't read the entire thing, but it just says, therefore be resolved that the following request be made for inclusion in the 2018 budget deliberations. And I'm bringing up one of the two at this point in time. Separation and collection bins with educational signing for the Town Park and Jack Berger Recreation Centers. And the reason why I'm raising that now is that what you have in front of you is the picture of, I think, slide 16 of Claudia Marcel's presentation that I asked everybody to have a look at that night. I've just given you a black and white photo. What I'd like to be able to do is have a line added to the to that budget submitted column for Center of Excellence that would refer to that fund. I sent an email and also left a message for Claudia on Friday and again on Monday. I'm not sure if she's out of the office at a conference or whatever. I have yet to hear back from her. What I'd like to do, and I'm using a term, I'm trying to remember the term, is it a placeholder, thank you. If we could put a placeholder for approximately $2,000 for those two sets of bins and the educational posters.
Is that a motion, sir?
Yes, it is.
Further discussion on that?
Yeah. Why would the committee not bring this forward?
The committee did, but it came in the form of this particular, because we don't have a specific way of, in other words, each of us has some kind of a connection. The connection here was this came through the after the fact that the budget had been put together. I believe that was the case. You had this the chart here with all the fees. This came in at that point in time through a report from staff.
Anybody in agreement we should add that in? Okay, perfect. Questions from David?
I'm just going to note, we had the letter that was received, and you'll note it's part of the actual agenda package. The typical amounts that we would have on here would be for just the regular operatings of the actual committees. So there was a request for the composter, and you'll note in your capital, there is a capital sheet that was added for the composter. In terms of the garbage and recycling centers and that information, and that was pending actual dialogue with the PRC committee so they could determine what it was that they needed to actually put in their operating budget. But my understanding when we discussed it was that a dialogue had not occurred from the committee to the actual department to be able to figure out what needed to go in. So it was included, it was received at the time, and we did review it, and we made sure it was in the agenda.
David, are you suggesting then that this would then come out of capital, or?
The composter would, right?
Yeah.
And then that's why there's a capital.
When we get back to capital, I want to
in terms of signage and you know, like one or two garbage and recycling containers, that would fit typically into our operating
budget. Because we have, Kevin is our sort of staff person from tourism and marketing, and then we have a staff person in our terms of reference from the works in engineering. I'm not sure which would be the most appropriate place to put that once we've decided what we're going to do with it. Do you have any recommendation?
Well, I thought the one was for them to be like at the Jack Berger or the Town Park Rec Center.
Yeah.
Maybe I misunderstood, but if that's the case, then it would go to PRC.
PRC
is responsible for those buildings.
Yeah, thank you.
Mayor Sanderson?
I think with the motion we've made, I don't see it different from the accessibility committee. This is a working group, and as such, I think they're going to need capital costs. They're going to actually implement programs, and I think the committee itself would have its own costs as well. So I think we should have the line item for the committee costs, and the capital costs are separate, as they would be from a revenue stream. If possible, recycling might become a revenue stream. So I think it's still in its infancy, but I think with our committee members, you know, putting in time and expense, and you know, things like even Claudia coming down, perhaps should be coming out of that working group committee costs. And then if they come forward with capital costs, which implement, you know, activities within the community that are in keeping with what council wants, I think that should be separate. So I like the idea of putting the $2,000 in there for the committee costs, and them coming forward if they have projects that would then become capital costs.
Everybody in agreement? Is that the way you want to handle that one? Okay.
So just to clarify, if the mover and seconder are in agreement, we're adding $2,000 to the Parks, Recreation, and Culture operating budget. Jim will tell me where the most appropriate spot is for that to go.
But it's a one-time cost.
Yes.
Right, but it'd be added to the operating budget. Right? $2,000 would be added to the operating budget. It may not be in there next year, but it'll be in there for 2018. And then there will need to be a dialogue between the Center of Excellence Working Group and PRC to determine about that going forward. That's how we'll...
Okay.
We're only going to add two of those, right?
Yep.
Well, I was just wondering, should we not have a third for like special events in Memorial Park? Because if we have a lot of special events in Memorial Park, wouldn't it be wise to add like three of them? One of the Town Park Rec Center, one of the Jack Burger, and then one for Memorial Park, because that seems to be where most of our special events are, and there's a lot of events and stuff going on. I would think you'd want three of them instead of two. That's just my opinion. Because we do a lot of events in Memorial Park yearly, and it's multiple, so, you know, unless you're going to keep moving them around, but I don't think that's the object here. I think you would almost want three of them. One for Memorial Park, because that's where all of our events are, and then one for each one of those. Those seem to be the busiest places in town, so.
And I don't have a problem with that, actually. In fact, I like that idea because it's a high traffic area. Aside from the collection of the material, the other part of this is the educational aspect, and this is what the committee is really working at, is an educational program, and this is just one part of many sort of avenues that are going to be going at.
One of the things that Martin's using is those solar compactors. Now, there would be, in the parks, there would be food waste, but we get into trouble because we can't clean those garbage cans a lot, so I think that would be something that this group should take a look at, is those solar compactors that Markham's using with great success. They last for a long time, and that would eliminate us having to go there first thing Monday morning and clear it all up, or Sunday, so that, and they're movable, they're solar powered, they've lasted for years, they're not inexpensive, but there would be a worthwhile project this group could take a look at, and I'm sure we could come up with funding for it.
We're talking $2,400. We spent 40 minutes on it. Go ahead.
I don't have a problem with that. In the Councillor Plickman, in the capital budget, but in the not included in the budget, way down at the bottom of the list is two earth cubes, you know, for a total of $7,500 each, similar to what we got across the way. Part of what we the dialogue with the Center of Excellence, they wanted to be able to get this thing up and running. Whether it's two earth cubes or one of those, I don't know the price on the big unit you were talking in terms of, but certainly we could explore that and maybe come back. We have a meeting next Wednesday morning.
One of the things is because there is funding available within the downtown beautification, which would be beautifying the downtown, is by cleaning it up. So we can take from there. It doesn't have to be part of the budget. This is just a council approval. So there is funding there for it. Because I had initially thought if we put four on Walton Street, then all of a sudden we're becoming a green. We're hitting all of the six check boxes that we're supposed to be hitting under the strategic plan. So it was my intent to use that money anyway. So there would be, it's into what you're wanting to do.
I'm comfortable with that. And I guess what we need to talk in terms of is just to carry the factor of three of those bin units at this point in time.
How much are they per unit? How much are they per unit?
At this point in time, I don't know. I'm guessing probably $1,000 each at this stage of the game. I'm hoping that I get something in the next day or so from Claudia.
Okay, put a placeholder for $3,000. Civic Awards, any comment on that?
Sorry, Mr. Chair. Can I maybe just ask the clerk? So we had a motion, we passed the motion, Then we had additional dialogue, which really changed what was going in our budget. We agreed to that, and now we've changed the amount again. So I'm just, I'm already in a bit of a gray area trying to make this work. I'm just thinking, if anyone goes and falls this after, it's very convoluted. Do we need another motion to add an additional $1,000? What should we be doing here?
Yeah, I'd suggest the final amount should be moved in the form of a motion. Whether that's an additional amount or just a,
Okay, that, in a sense, do we have to rescind the original motion or we just ignore it?
Just make a motion for the additional amount.
Okay. I would move that we allow for $3,000 towards...
No, add $1,000.
Add $1,000.
Okay.
For the bins. For the bins.
All in favor? Thank you. Civic Awards, any comment on that? Heritage Incentive Program, I see quite a variance there. Who has that committee?
No, I'm on that
panel. Oh, Terry, could you just make a comment on this?
I actually can't fill you in on all the details because I don't have that information. I realize we've got the documents in front of us, but I'm not really up to speed on that big difference. Well, it says it's coming from the Hydro Reserve.
Councilor Plevin?
Going through the numbers, it appears what that is just an accumulation of money that wasn't used. Okay, so that they get the same amount each year, but it wasn't actually utilized, and so what they're doing is throwing it all together, saying, even though we didn't use it, we want to be able to use it this year, and if we had, what is it, $35,000 a year?
Yeah.
Yeah, so they didn't use it for 4 years, so now they want to be able to say, we want to be able to have all of that available on the incentive. That's where the numbers come from.
Councilor Butcher?
I think there were some grants that were given out, and there was a two-year time period, and the downtown business property owners didn't comply in time, so the committee basically said, we're not giving that money, and we're taking it back, putting it in the pot. So that's exactly it. It's money that's just hasn't been spent, so it's just accumulated. So we have more to give out in the next room.
We have historically done that in the past, clawed back and held it in reserve. Okay, that's fine. Heritage Portal. Councilor Fletcher?
Just go to that page. I do have a bit of a concern about where this money comes in. So the Heritage Port Hope Committee is proposing that a study be undertaken to develop an inventory of all the heritage properties in the municipality, both designated and undesignated, in order to create an inventory, and then from that inventory, council can decide whether to create a list from this or to designate them. The concern is that we have issues come up on an urgent basis that we need to address, and we don't have any protection in place to deal preemptively with these buildings. So the suggestion is to apply for a Canada summer jobs grant, and I believe the archives applied for that last year and got a $5,000 grant. So there's a member of the committee said they could write that grant. So what my concern is, though, is I'm not sure that this is something that should be done by the committee or if it should be something done by operationally through the planning department with our heritage planner overseeing this. And the only reason why I'm saying this is that just a bit of a chicken and the egg thing. Who does this first? Is does the municipality take this on, and then we ask the Heritage Committee to advise us in terms of that, or does the Heritage Committee take it on? They're willing to take it on, but I mean, procedurally, I'm not sure where this should go. This should go into the operating budget of the planning department and be overseen and coordinated by them, and or should it go to, are we comfortable with this going to a committee to prepare this list? So.
David, you have a question?
From an HR side, I'd suggest that if we're actually hiring someone, that it not be left in the hands of the committee to be hiring an employee, albeit a summer student, that there'd be they can be involved, but I like the suggestion of having it through the planning department.
Councilor Plevin?
I'm in agreement with Director Baxter. This is, if the municipality is going to do this, it should be staff doing this as a staff job and not committee members doing it. And the committee currently does have a very large catalog of designated properties already, which they had done a number of years ago with a grant. So there would be part that could transfer to the municipality and so that they could complete it. But I'd be far more comfortable if it was municipal staff and not a committee member.
Deputy Mayor?
You took the words slightly out of my mouth, and that is that catalog. I was on the advisory committee as a citizen at that point in time, and it's a very comprehensive document. It's a great starting point for, I think, what they want to accomplish here, but I would agree. I think this needs to be in staff hands rather than a part-time person that has a huge learning curve. We've got that kind of expertise right now.
So are you suggesting we eliminate the variance?
I'm suggesting that we put the money into the operating budget of the planning department, and that the money actually is put aside. So $5,000 will go into the planning budget for the heritage planner to oversee this project, and an application be made to Canada Summer Jobs. And if we get the $5,000 grant from Canada Summer Jobs, then it's not a cost to the municipality. But we have to set aside the money if we decide we need to do this, so that the money is there to be spent. And if we get the job paid for through Canada Summer Jobs, and then that's great, then we don't have to spend that money.
Would you like to make a motion?
Sure, I'd like to make a motion that the $5,000, it is $5,000. Because the Canada Summer Grant will fund $5,000. So,
if you get the grant, you don't.
If you get, exactly. So I would like to propose that $5,000 be placed into the operating budget of the planning department for a project to hire a summer student to prepare a list of undesignated properties and designated properties for the municipality. And the committee seems to think that that would be enough time to put this list together. So, and applying for a grant through Canada Summer Jobs, and that the municipality would pay for this, and if we are reimbursed, then I guess it would be on the budget. So.
Discussion? Mayor Sanders?
Just a modification of undesignated. Everything is undesignated. We're really trying to define those buildings that have potential for designation. Just to clarify the motion. So what you're trying to do is accumulate a list of those properties that are eligible but not currently designated, rather than all undesignated properties.
It's to create a list of historically significant properties in the municipality that could go on a list or be designated, but it's to create a list of, first of all, to create an inventory. It's actually, the motion says to create an inventory of heritage properties. We have the designated list already, but these are the properties that have not been designated but that are historically significant. So to create an inventory of those projects, I'm not saying to list them, I'm saying that would come to council for a decision later, but it's about creating an inventory so we have an inventory of those properties.
That's the clarification I'm looking for, because all undesignated properties are all properties in Portville.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Okay, tree advisory.
With respect to approval of the amount for Heritage Port Hope, then, because it was, they were looking for an additional $3,450.
It's
approved.
It was approved.
So they're going to get $5,950.
Tree advisory. Who's tree advisory? Councilor Hickey.
Yeah, the difference from last year is
that's the variance from last year.
The difference from last year really goes into the amount, because there's been a lot of mileage accrued by the different members going out and inspecting trees. There's been a lot of that this year, so that's virtually what all this request is for.
Anybody have any issue with that? No? Okay. Any other comments on committees and council?
Les, can we, from the chair, Can we clarify exactly what we're doing here? Because if we move $5,000, the committee adjustment form says the committee proposes to develop a catalog of heritage properties, Port Hope designated and undesignated. Last year's budget did not have anything in that line item, which is contract services. So this year they put $5,000 in that line item for exactly what Louise, a counselor, was speaking to. And so we need to understand, our thought here is that we move that $5,000 into the planning budget and remove $5,000 from the committees of council's budget. And so we just want to make sure we're understanding what you'd like staff to do.
If I can just clarify, the reason why the budget was larger last year for Heritage Port Hope was there was money put in there for the 40th anniversary. So we're going back to the budget that they need to operate the committee without that $1,000, and then the $5,000 would go into the budget. Does that make sense then? So they're looking, so I guess their budget would be $950, I guess. Okay.
Yeah. Recording secretaries, Deputy Mayor, you had a question?
When I went down through here, I couldn't find anywhere where there was the secretarial cost for the secretary for the Center of Excellence Working Group. We do have a secretary like all the other boards, committees, and we pay. So I'm assuming, and this is where I need some direction maybe from staff, but I'm assuming it'll be $850, similar to the other ones.
Sanderson?
We allocated a committee budget for the working costs of the committee. Would that not be included in that?
So in essence, my motion is that we add in $850 to cover the cost of secretary for the Center of Excellence Working Group.
Okay, do we need a motion to do that?
Yeah, so typically for the other ones, we have that in the budget, but I do not see a line for the Center of Excellence.
I'd suggest the motion be entertained at the $850 for a recording secretary.
Moved by Deputy Mayor, seconded by Councilor Hickey. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. And Louise, you had a question regarding?
Yes, I'm just noting under the recording secretary budget that there, and I'm not sure why, Heritage Port Hope also doesn't have somebody. It has $0 under Heritage Port Hope. So, and there is a secretary there. I assume she's being paid. And there's always, I think previously we had a staff member who was doing that, and then we had some turnover of staff, so then we do have a secretary there. So I'd just like to put a motion on the floor to also have a budgeted item for, if it's $850 for a secretary for Heritage Port Hope, as that position is being
seconded. Councilor Lees, further discussion?
Yeah.
All in favor?
Yeah. Okay, so we're going to go down through this list. There's a lot of committees that don't have secretarial funding on here. We have, every one of our committees does not have a secretary. Assuming so. I don't know. It's an incomplete list. We found a couple. Why don't we just have finance, before we do this one, have finance go through just to double check. Are they all there?
That's all here.
It is?
Yeah. Below the committees itself is all the secretarials.
Yeah, and I'm looking at that list. So far you've missed two that we've had to add on. I'm just saying, are they all there? Yeah, there is. There's again a rescue advisory, but it's not us. Yeah, that's them.
Hold on. You're saying that we don't have a committee for Ganarasta, so that one can come off?
Could we have finance just go through this and they could get back to us later on this little bit of a week?
Okay. Is that the one of council that?
You can help me with with this, Councilor Vase, I think in terms of Parks, Recreation, and Culture Committee, it notes there that they already have secretarial help, and I assume that that's one of the full-time staff. Like, no? But is it included in your budget? Yeah, that's what I thought. So, and we don't have a Gannett Raska River Advisory Committee at this point in time, but the assumption is somewhere along the line that'll come under probably Parks, Recreation, and Culture, but I'm not sure if it says secretarial here. Same thing with Cemetery Board. The Labor Relations Committee, I'm assuming they don't need one. The Property Standards Committee doesn't need one. Audit Committee, no. Council Member Remuneration Committee, no. Livestock, no. Lions Club, no. So I think we've got them all covered in the chart above. It was just those two that I think were missing.
Excuse me, Mr. Chair, if I could weigh in. Budget Committee has added the Heritage Port Hope Recording Secretary. That is a full list of all of our committees. The Gannett Raska River Advisory Committee has been established by Council. We simply have not had the number of applicants needed to form the committee. It's been established for quite some time. It would be remiss to remove the line item for Recording Secretary should we get that established in the very near future. Seeing that we've added the Heritage Port Hope Recording Secretary back in, I believe we are well covered for our committees of council.
Can we move on? Okay, thank you. Anything further on committees of council? No? Okay, good. That's a wrap. That didn't take long.
Mr. Chair, from the dialogue that was had, we identified $950 for Heritage Port Hope in terms of the committee of council budgets. So, can we get some direction on the other committees before we move from the section of the budget?
What do you need?
A general vote for all.
Yeah, we need to know how else to fill out column C, the 2018 proposed. We need amounts for there. And then we need a motion to have direction to include that in the budget.
Is everybody comfortable for $2,400 there?
Yep.
Okay. $4,000 for civic awards. As committee of adjustments, there's a negative.
Generators.
That's fine. I was happy with those.
Zero.
And the incentive program, heritage incentive program, carry over. Okay. Heritage Port Hope, $950, and tree advisory increased to $2,000. All those in favor?
Did you have the motion?
We need a motion. Motion to approve the committees of council budget for 2018. Have a mover, please. Councilor Hickey, seconded by Deputy Mayor Burns. All in favor? Okay. Community grants. Okay.
Donation?
No, I've got community grants next. Okay, we'll do donations. 2018 donations? Have these formally come in, or are we just keying off last year's expectations?
The 2018 request column is what was requested in 2018.
Requested in 18?
Yep. Okay. The requests from 2017 are also loaded.
Okay. You want to take a second to see all? Go ahead, Mayor Sanderson.
We've had this discussion sort of each year, and these are rollover type donations, right? And we expect them to come forward, but many of them don't come forward till the last minute. So I think the same as last year, rather than spending a whole bunch of time debating these, I think if we put an award amount down, you know, and then wait for those people to come, because they're high school awards, they're, you know, community awards that come forward, and it's like every business in town, they they wait till the last minute and they expect it, but their processes aren't very good. So I would recommend that we just take an amount, you know, and allocate it the same as last year, right? And then divvy it up accordingly. We continually have said, these repeat every year. You know, so rather than be sort of on the community grants, if we know they're occurring, I think we try to modify the process, and we should try to stick with that.
Is this not included in the council budget as a line item of $5,000 to handle these type of things?
It was last time.
And we've already approved that budget, that part of the budget, so this falls under.
Right. So right at this point, there's a $5,000 provision for this in the council operating budget.
And this is the detail.
Right. The want was, instead of these coming out throughout the year, one or two at each budget committee meeting, to deal with them as a group, all the ones that were recurring or we could foresee, there may still be something that comes up in March, right, that's a new initiative of some sort to deal with those few kind of as they occur, which you can leave funds, as long as you leave funds in your account for those. But the one at this point, these organizations have applied now. We don't anticipate they'll be applying again later, right? This is when they have applied. And so what we would anticipate is to make a decision on the current applicants, deal with them all as a group for efficiency sakes, and then determine how much money you, additional money you want for things that come up during the year.
So is council comfortable? We have $5,000 in our council budget to handle these type of requests. So we, you know, these may or may not come forward, but we do have provision in there for them.
I think we know these will come forward because they traditionally have. Right? But then I think the council budget, from my perspective, is for those ones that weren't anticipated, you know, year after year, and it allows council some discretion in donating. It could be, you know, something, a student going to an awards or a competition or something like that. Those can't be anticipated, so I think council does need to have some discretionary ability to address those requirements that come forward, requests that come forward. But these ones are sort of traditional, you know, and I think we know they're going to come forward, so we should budget for them. And it could either be within the council budget, so it gets increased, so they're not separate. But when we know they're coming, we should budget for it. And then we should budget something for those that aren't in the process and come up, you know, spontaneously.
Well, okay. So now you've got me confused because we have the money in the budget. Do we want to increase the council budget? Okay. Well, this money has to come from somewhere, so it's coming out of the council budget. Okay, so we don't have to re-approve this, do we?
No, but I do know in the agenda, all these organizations of the 2018 request, this is the time where they are requesting. The want of budget committee, right, was to get as many of these so that you could deliberate them right now. So yes, there's a $5,000 in the budget. So one part is if you want that amount to be more or less than $5,000, that would need to be moved. And I'm not getting a sense of that is, but that just to be clear, that's one discussion. The other decision that needs to be that we need is whether you are approving the 2018 requests. These aren't up here because we anticipate they're going to ask for them again because they did last year. These are actual requests that are in the agenda. They are requesting them now for 2018. We would need direction on each of these requests, please.
First of all, I have Louise and then Greg.
I'd like to make a motion to approve the St. Mary's Catholic Secondary School, the District 12 Summer 55 Games, as requested, the 100, the 250. I think we should put in the $600 for Port Hope High School, anticipating that they will ask for that. And then under the non-annual donations, Northumberland Navy League, I assume that's cadets. That'd be cadets, I'll approve that. Hope Agricultural Heritage Club, I'll approve, yep. Motion to approve that. And I'd just like some explanation as to what the J.A. Peterborough Lakeland Muskoka is.
David's well, looking for that, Deputy Mayor.
I know the motion's on the floor, and I don't have any issue with what you've put forward so far, other than I want to indicate that my service club, the Beauty Lions Club, chose to provide the Hope Agricultural Heritage Club for that $950. They'll have a check presented to them this coming Monday. So we, in fact, can remove that from the budget.
I will make that amendment to my motion.
Yeah, so looking at their request form, which for anyone following along, right, we are at section 5.14 on the agenda. JA might previously have been junior achievement, yeah. Although it doesn't seem like they call it that anymore.
I have no problem with that since we've just taken the service club to 150 out. So let's get some leadership training for our young people. I'll support that. That's my motion.
Clear out the motion.
Can I just clarify, in terms of the Portal High School, do you want us to go on the basis that that's approved such that when we get the request, we just automatically approve it?
Yes.
Okay. Do I have a seconder? Seconded by Councilor Plutnik. All those in favor? Deputy Mayor?
I'm not sure if others feel the same way, but I have a little bit of a problem with the Peterborough Lakeland Muskoka. I like what they're doing, but I'm not so sure that that's something that municipal taxpayers should be funding versus a service club or whatever. I just have difficulty with us putting, I know it's only $999 or whatever, but I just have a concern that we're setting a precedent there.
Councilor Plutnik and then Councilor Lee.
It is, they are offering, from what I read, it is a class for our 30 students here within the municipality to learn about readiness, global economics, and entrepreneurship, which is something that, I mean, after being with the idea of and everything else, one of the things that we really don't work on a lot in this community is our youth, to take them to the next stage. And I think this might be something that would help. And if it gets 30 young people to take a look at going into sciences, technologies, entrepreneurship, I think it's $900 is a cheap price to pay for that. I mean, we'd be able to evaluate after the first year and call it a day, but it's 30 kids that may never get an opportunity to play in this kind of realm.
Dr. Lee, you're okay?
Yeah, just reading through this, I just wanted to know, it actually looks like CAMCO is going to pay for this program to go in two of the other schools in Port Hope, and is looking for us to pay, essentially, municipality to pay for the third school, such that I think this goes to all three schools. So I'm not disagreeing with your point. Education taxes are done separately, and whether we should be involved or not in audits is an ongoing challenge, but I did just want to point out that it looks like the plan here is to go to all three schools, and if we were not to fund it, Canada would be paying for this group to come to two schools, and then maybe one of the schools would miss out. Is
my opinion. Comfortable with that?
I have no problem with what you said as to, you know, what the good positive impact this would be. It's just my concern is, are we setting a precedent relative to municipal taxpayers paying for something like this?
Hopefully so. I think this is something that the municipal taxpayers will actually receive a benefit in the end.
Okay. Motion's on the floor. Any further discussion? Those in favor? Carried. Thank you. Okay, so you're comfortable with donations? Okay. No offense. No, this is why we make the big bucks. Okay. Chris Anderson?
Just a point, because we've gone through the approval of the requests, and that comes out of the $5,000 the council budget has, which doesn't seem to be that, I'm not sure what the total is, but doesn't leave much discretion for council during the year.
Yeah, $20,000.
Okay. discussion?
We spoke a little bit of legal room.
Community grants. You can't start before we bring it up. Okay, go ahead, Deputy Rick.
Thank you. It's just an overall question, and I spoke to David, I think, yesterday about it. Just a question. Were all of those who were either approved or were turned down, they were all dealt with by the same criteria and the same process?
That is correct.
Thank you. That's all I want to know.
I think we're going to go line by line and approve them line by line so that we don't get into the jumble at the end. Santa Claus Parade, same as was approved for 2017. Are we okay? I think we'll put them up on the board, massage them, and then make a motion on the whole thing. Okay? So you go ahead, Jim.
I'd like to make a motion that we approve the $4,000 for the Santa Claus Parade for this year.
Second. Anybody, Councilor Hickey? Mayor Sanderson?
I'd like to add $1,000 to that.
Out of his pocket.
No, they didn't ask him that deal. I don't know.
Santa Claus.
Having listened for 3 years, being explained all of the press as everything comes by, as we stand out there from Councilor Lee's, if they wanted the money, they would have asked for the money. I think the $4,000 is well within what they require and what we approved before.
We just sat funny minutes about over $1,000 for these kids. And then you want to add $1,000 to Santa Claus? That's all we're asking for, so give it to
them. Okay, so all in favor of $4,000? All right, thank you. Float your fanny down the gang. Okay, so the approved amount was $10,000 in 2017. The variance is $20,000. We had a presentation by Barry Adamson in November outlining three options. Leave it as it is, and it could be due to failure because of lack of volunteers. Bring it in under staff or subcontract out. So we never did have a full discussion. And Barry is here today, but we need to call on him. So go at it.
Could maybe I just ask for Barry, if you wouldn't mind just coming to the microphone and explain the difference between the 10 and the 30. What the majority of that is made up of.
Sorry, explain the difference between what? I'm sorry?
The 10 that you got last year and the 30.
Oh, the request for the $20,000 more than last year was to go into the areas that was in the grant here. And let me just get to that page, I'm sorry. It's to pay for staff in the as we've been doing this for a volunteer basis. We can't carry on doing it that way anymore. So to go into the for this to staff was, I believe, $17,000. And then some of the new things, because of the size of the crowds and the how popular it's becoming, we're going to have to change the area at the finish line, requiring more fencing. We've got to do some work down there that requires more security. We have to work with Chief Ryan to make things work better down there. So him and I both feel that we have better crowd control and safe. So this is what the funds were put in there for. We've got it up there, and I can't even read it here, but extra security and the fencing. Thank you, that's much better. And some of the area manager's costs, I can't be in three places at once, so I'm going to have to get some people to do it. And as I can't get volunteers, I'm going to have to hire some management to help work on these different areas. So that was what the suggestion was of why I've asked for it.
Any questions?
Have we ever been able to evaluate the economic impact on the community? I know we get a huge amount of publicity for the community, and congratulations again, I think you're in the top 100 events in Canada. But I don't know if we've ever taken some of these events and tried to figure out what the economic impact is on the community. It's hopefully substantial.
Mayor Baba, I presented, I think it was about 3 years ago, an economic impact study that was done through the provincial government. And we basically, off the top of my head, I don't have the report in front of me, but it was about $140,000 just for the town alone on the impact of that day. There's a whole study done with which I did present, I believe, in the I put it in the paperwork when it came in earlier. But there has been a very, very significant the impact, and this is done by basically an outside company looking at all the different factors that come in. So it is significant, sir.
Councilor Plutnik.
Barry, the $17,004. This is a part-time job, or this is a year-round salary?
This is a part-time job. This is just simply the.
Define the time, so this would be like a 3 month period that this would be?
Or? This is over a, for Floetcher Fanning, it's over a, almost a half a year, I guess. We start working on it in September, and it goes through to April, and then you're cleaning up after that, so it's almost all year round. But in the hours that are spent on it, it's more of a half year job.
Okay, does this include benefits or anything, or just straight salary?
That's strictly the costs on everything. That's strictly the fact that money will be given as a contract, and everything else after that is taken care of.
Do you anticipate this going up next year?
Anticipate it going up next year? Yeah, I would say yes, because it hasn't been looked at and studied. And part of this year is to get actual hours and actual time, so that if I have to come next year and stand in front of you, I come forth and say, here's what it took to do it last year, and here's the actual numbers of hours that were spent, so that we could significantly, you know, defend what's going on. Right now, it's a guess. This is what we're going to do, and we've said, okay, for this amount of money, we could do it this year, and we'll find out what's happening next year.
Okay, thank you. Just last night during our discussions, when we were talking about return on investment of dollars put in the project, and part of it, this is where you get into, is the capital theater returns X number of people. Each one of these events do return people, but now you're getting down into it. So it's going to be a difficult thing to measure in my mind to come up with a criteria that is fair to everybody, because this is now getting to where we've been fortunate, never had to pay for it. There's a huge plus there, but now we're going to be paying for it, so that this could in 2 years be at the same price point as the Capitol Theater. So I'd just like to throw that out there after last night's discussion.
Fortunately, everything can't be measured by metrics, and you know, how do you measure Santa Claus Parade, Canada Day, which are institutions to us? It's like apple pie.
Yep. Just all these events lately, and I mean, you know, we're sitting here trying to make them even on the same plateau. Well, it's really difficult. I mean, I've been down, you know, I was part of the Floetcher Fanning years ago with Russell Boat and Nancy, when Barry and his group, we had enough and they took over, and the same with Canada Day. And it's hard to get these things on the same playing field with all of them, because some of them, you know, are one-time events, some of them are, you know, year-round establishments like the Capitol, some of the firefighter museums. We're trying to get the same plateau here, and it's hard to deal with them all, and it's tough because, you know, times are changing, and I understand the same with Barry, his group is tired, the same as the Kinsmen were with Canada Day. You can't do it anymore the way you did, because volunteerism isn't the same, but then on the other hand, you've got the Capitol, who has, you know, hundreds of volunteers and different structures and stuff like that. And we're trying to come up with a solution that fits them all, and it's very difficult because they're all different, they're all same, they're all good events, they're all, you know, real mainstays of Port Hope. They all mean, you know, and they're all good causes, they all do great jobs. We have a lot of people in this community that work very hard for all these groups, and they're all good causes. None of them are bad things, we all agree on that. But the problem is to try to come up with the same playing field with them all, and it's almost impossible because some, you know, like Barry's event, Canada Day, they're all free. There's no charge for most of them. But then you have the Capitol Theater, you have other, you know, the other ones that charge to get in. So this is a very, very tough thing for me to sit here and try to make an even playing field for them all, and you can't. And I mean, it's, they're all great causes. Everybody does great work. We all, you know, there's a ton of volunteers out there that help as well. But as we all know, people aren't volunteering the same as they used to. And if you look around with all these groups, it's the same volunteers for most of them. They're all helping with each event. And I mean, so how do you come up with a same playing field for them all? It's tough. And I'm struggling with this one, and I'm struggling with a couple of the other ones as well. Because on the other hand, I have a hard time knowing that we're giving out taxpayers' dollars and eventually it's going into someone's pocket to make a job for them. So, and then other ones, you have volunteers doing the same thing for nothing. So how is that fair to everybody? And I don't know how we're going to come up with something that's fair for everybody, because you look down the list and that's what we're going to run into here. The rest of the day, we're going to pound this thing out probably for an hour or two, trying to figure out something that's fair for everybody. And I don't honestly think we can. I really don't. That's just a comment.
Deputy Mayor?
I couldn't agree with you more. It's frustrating. I think all of us have spent a lot of time. This is a very, it becomes an emotional issue as well. And I guess the way I look at it is that we have this in front of us now, as we've had for the last 2 or 3 years, and we need to make those decisions. But I hope what comes out of this, just to follow up in your comments, is that when we turn this over to the next council, I would like to, between now and when we complete our term of office, whether it's a combination of a couple of members of council and some staff, to look at this and how we would recommend. It's almost like a legacy document that you're passing on to the next council. I think that's something that we need to do, so that, because right now, it's, as you pointed out, it's loosey-goosey, how do you approach it kind of thing. I've got some recommendations, as I'm sure everybody does, about certain situations, but I guess what I'm faced with now is I have to make a decision based on how I feel about the group and whether it's something that has a major impact on the community, but also we may be looking at different ways of how, for each one of these, you know, as to how we make that selection. But one of the recommendations, and I'm not necessarily putting a motion, but just food for thought, is that we somehow create a group, a combination of staff and council, to look at this issue and come up with something solid that we can turn over to the next council, so they're not in the same kind of situation that we are in. But I couldn't agree with you more. It's a very emotional kind of thing, because each of us have an attachment to maybe one, two, or three of these groups.
Councilor Plouffe?
I agree with you, Deputy Mayor, but we did that last year for this year. We did come up with criteria. There is not ever going to be a fair criteria. How we apply this, there are going to be institutions, groups, or events that are going to go, I think ours is more important than yours. That's where this gets difficult. I mean, one of the things that we got on the first council, a friend of mine, Mr. Broughton, pointed out that we actually spent more time talking about $150,000 in donations than we did on the $18 million in the budget. I mean, if we just said, here, boom, it's done, and moved on, really, how much of a difference is it going to make? I mean, there are some questions that I do have. I want to know, how come this is going to that particular area? I mean, there's a lot of management fees that are coming in this time that we've never presented on any of the things before. So I'd like, it's not to say no, I just want to understand why that management fee is coming in or coming in at that level. So I think there's questions that have to be answered, but I don't have a problem in spending. I would approve it as it's written here.
Deputy Mayor?
Again, no disagreement. And I just think back, actually my wife reminded me of it over the weekend when I was walking through this, and it's an emotional issue. In 1981, I was the Parks and Recreation and Culture Director 2 weeks into the job, and the City of Cambridge Council was dealing with the same kind of situation. Back then they had about $200,000 or $300,000 in the budget. That meeting started at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and it ended at 1:45 in the morning, right straight through. And there were groups sitting as they are now at 1:30 in the morning waiting to be heard. I spent a whole year with my staff investigating, a fulsome investigation of what's happening across the province, how people are doing it. The next year when we went through this process, we did it in just over 2 hours as compared to basically 10 hours. And I guess what I'm suggesting is that I think it's incumbent upon us to look at this once again so that when this comes up again, we can make those decisions. I don't disagree with you. I'm prepared to look at this and say, you know what? I don't want to spend 4 hours talking about this. Let's just move this forward at this point in time and approve these. There obviously will be some questions, but to me, I don't want to spend the next 2 hours talking about this.
Councilor Hickey?
Mr. Addison, coming back to you, you've been so patiently standing there.
Here.
So the last year's budget was just under $30,000, and you're anticipating the 2018 budget is just under $50,000. So could we assume that we've kind of reached a tipping point in this event, that in order to, like, I mean, if we said to you, why don't we just do it the same as last year? Can we do it for $27,000 to $32,000 type of thing, and just have everything go exactly the same way as last year? Are you saying to us that basically we no longer can do it the way we've been doing it in the past, and we need something different? I'm just trying to get clarification.
That's what I'm saying, sir. I'm saying that no, we could not do it this year at that same price. That's why I've brought this budget forward. That's why I came and did the presentation earlier, whatever it was in November, whenever I came. Saying no, we cannot do it this year at that price.
Thank you.
Thank you, Barry. I know there was some discussion about having this event taken on by the municipality, as we've done with Canada Day, but we just can't take on every event every year. I think that's kind of the direction that council's having some struggles with. I think that in terms of an event for this community, I mean, every community has a Santa Claus parade, every community has a Canada Day parade, but only Port Hope has Float Your Fanny. And I think this is probably the event that so many people, it kickstarts our spring, it gets everybody in a good mood when the weather's good, and I think it's something that we have to support. What the dollar value is there, I'm not sure, but I know that there are members of council who have are going out and talking to other sponsors and trying to get people to come on board to help out. What I think we can do as a municipality is also help to promote this better in terms of advertising for more volunteers and to help this. You're a very small committee, dedicated family. It's basically your family that takes this on. And I think it would behoove us to do a little bit more through our social media platforms to make the community aware that these events that everybody wants to come out and participate in only run on the huge benefit of volunteers like yourself. So I think that we all need to do a better job of that. And I know our service clubs all get very stretched with the events they take on, but maybe there's another group that we can help. I know you try to find volunteers, but we all need to kind of work towards that. So maybe a communication that goes out from the municipality, we can assist in that area. So I don't know where the dollar value is going to land, but we'll definitely be supporting it at some level.
Thank you.
Councilor Beast?
As an event for this community, I mean, there's no doubt that this one is phenomenal. It has been built over 36 years by different various groups of people that have, including myself, put a lot of time and effort into this event. And I mean, the bottom line is, does the municipality want this event to continue? And if we do, we have to back it with money. So let's just cut to the chase. I would like to make a motion that we approve the request of Float Your Fanny down the Gannon for $30,000 for this year's event. I'd like to make that motion.
Seconded by Councilor Hickey. Discussion? Mr. Anderson?
I thought we were just going to approve this and do it all at once rather than individual motions. So.
No, that's not. We
need to say
everything.
Okay.
What I suggested, but that's what we've done on the first one, so we're going to do it on this one.
So
and go on. All those in favor? Barry. Thank you, Barry.
Thank you. And by the way, my dream is that we will find a sponsorship and I'll be able to give you all the money back that we have asked for. So we're out looking, but...
This is being recorded, I want you to know.
Yeah, yeah. Mary, can you turn around?
Thank you.
Okay, physician recruitment, we received that. Deputy Mayor?
I would move that we approve the $14,925 for the Community Physician Recruitment and Retention Committee's request for a community grant.
Seconded by Councilor Putnam. All in favor? Discussion?
Discussion after we approve.
Yeah.
Did we talk about it outside? Okay. Greenwood Coalition, we granted $10,000 last year. They've asked for another $4,000 this year, bringing it to $14,000. Anybody care to speak to this? Councilor Fletcher?
I'm satisfied with keeping it at $10,000. I know Greenwood does, they service members of this community that don't often get serviced, and I think it's a great street front organization that helps to support so many people. So I propose that we support this at $10,000 at last year.
Seconded by Councilor Lees. Any further discussion? Deputy Mayor?
If we could just for a moment, because we did it with the previous group, if we could maybe ask David, yeah, David's out there. David, would you like to come and just give us a quick overview of this funding request?
Really, thank you. The funding request is specifically for the arts-based programming that Greenwood offers, and that is offered at no cost to anyone in the community. And so using our downtown space, providing some programmed activities and also the free drop-in space there. The kind of outreach component of it are things like the Arts Festival in the Park when we quote and do those kinds of events. We did a poetry pop-up at Cultivate Festival as well. So all of those things that kind of connect. Our philosophy is to build a stronger community by connecting folks who are disadvantaged with those who aren't disadvantaged. And so by offering something that's free and accessible, we can do that. Last year we asked for $20,000, which represents the true cost of delivering that program, and so the 14 is a reflection of paying for a bit more of that. Otherwise, the funding for that comes from the community, but it comes out of what might be spent on outreach and some of the other harm reduction programs that we do.
Deputy Mayor, then Councilor Lees.
Just a quick question. In comparison to the level of service, the number of times that you did what you did last year with the 10,000, is this an increase? In other words, that your outreach is extensively more?
So this is asking for a little more activity than we did last year, so we asked for $20,000 last year. We essentially delivered $20,000 of activity last year, and so as I said, that extra funding, if we provide that, has to come from some other aspect of what we're doing. So this would support that and can sort of balance that out a little bit.
Councilor Lees, then Councilor Plutnik.
David, no doubt, I really congratulate you on all the work you guys do. You guys do great work with people in the community, and thank you. My concern is the administration fees and management fees. In your whole operational, it doesn't really tell us what it costs you in admission, what you pay out to employees. Do you have amount of employees and what you pay in a year? Can you tell us what that is? And
so I don't know. Yeah,
but it says you pay a certain amount for your regular fees, and then 400 hours at $25 an hour for operating program. That's not the full amount though that you pay for the full year, is it?
So that for the arts-based programming, that's what we spend on salaries for that programming. And so for the rest of the organization, so we currently have 3 part-time employees, a total of 78 hours a week that are paid to salary.
And that's year-round?
That's year-round, yes.
And a full-time person too?
That's all of the staffing, that includes me. So total of 3 people, 78 hours, and that's our arts programming, outreach programming, harm reduction. We do needle exchange. We do the Red Path Recovery Program. All of those things. So if you look at our budget, all of our funding, staff funding, goes into programs. We don't have a bunch of administrative overhead.
Thank you very much.
David, I'm just looking at the numbers that you've presented on the spreadsheet here, and you're showing for 2018 that the programming costs aren't actually going up, but the staff wages are going up $10,000, and your other costs are going up by $1,940. It seems that it's administrative side that the additional funding is for, not for actual programming.
Sorry, where's the...
Salaries are going from 64 in 2016 to 85 in 2017 to 95 in 2018. The programming costs went from 94 to 14, but it will stay at 14. I'm not certain what other costs are, but they've gone up $10,000 in 2 years, and staff costs have gone up, almost 30 in 2 years. Mm-hmm. The programming cost is the one that appears to be stabilized there.
So the program, all of that staff, as I just explained, all of that staffing is program related. The way that's set up, it really doesn't reflect the cost of those programs in that way.
You need to present this better. If the way that it's showing, David, is it's showing your staffing costs are increasing by 50% in 2 years, basically.
Right.
And your programming costs aren't going up. So it's costing you twice as much to have a person do the same job. That's what that is saying. So it may not be accurate. That's what it's saying.
Yes. So those are, program costs are program costs. Those are physical costs, and staffing costs are staffing. Yeah, so I agree that that is confusing.
Okay, thank you.
Has it been seconded? Seconded by the mayor. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Thank you.
Local food for local good. We had a presentation yesterday by Nicole, Emmy, and Jeff. Any questions regarding this? Mayor Sanderson?
I would move the same as you did last time, which is keep it the same as last year.
Second by Councilor Lees. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Yep. Sounds of the next federation. This one we entertained last year. Did we not approve money for it?
We did not.
I've had a little bit of first-hand knowledge on this, and it's quite a program that they're running. Any comments?
The same kind of comment as you. I know a little bit about it, not a heck of a lot about it, but when I look at the age group and the sort of demographic that we're looking at, I would certainly be prepared to put a motion on the floor for a $2,000 grant.
Can I second it?
$2,000.
Can I second? No, sorry. Seconded by Mayor Sanderson. Discussion. Councilor Lutnick?
Why reduce it 500? Just curious. I mean, it's just,
I mean, if that requested $2,500, why are we reducing it? I mean, I know nothing about this group, so I mean, if I'm assuming that they've gone through their numbers and said this is what we need. If that's what we need, I don't see the $2,500, you know.
Then with the permission of the seconder, I'd be prepared to amend it to $2,500.
Seconder agrees. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Carried. Okay. Critical mass. Who can speak to this?
Charles is here.
Well, important to you.
Okay. I think maybe at this point in time it might be helpful to have Charles come to as chair of critical mass.
Turn the microphone on.
Great. Thank you. I actually didn't come prepared to speak. I do apologize. I was hoping to answer any questions. Our dilemma is much the same as Fletcher Fanning. Right now, we're relying completely on volunteers, and it's a full-time volunteer job that we're relying on. We're relying on people to become a career for them, and that's not sustainable. We're also at the cusp of what critical mass is. We're at the turning point where it's either go big or go home. So we need to have professional people working with us. They're not full-time jobs, but we need to be able to hire resources to complete certain tasks around certain events, as well as on an ongoing basis for a curatorial sense. Our big initiatives for this year are the continuing programming of the Mini MoMA Museum, which right now is in the library. And next, I think in the new year, it'll go to the Visitor Center. The Little Station, which was the yacht club, has to be relocated as part of the Portal Barrier Initiative. And we've been working with Parks and Rec and Tourism as to the possibility of, and this building is actually owned by the ACO, I should clarify, relocating that building and to Lance Lane and restoring it. Critical mass would then hopefully become the tenant. And so we would have to make certain investments as well in terms of upgrading the interior to suit our purposes and then for the continued programming of that space. But what this would mean is we would have Critical Mass, the Center for Contemporary Art in Port Hope, a permanent bricks and mortar structure that could be open year round or for specific events. We are committed to having continued smaller installations around town during the course of the year. Right now, I think you have all seen, or I hope you've seen, the installation in Watson's window for the Christmas period. Previously, we had used the windows of the Walton Hotel, which are still available to us as well. But Dave Watson has very kindly provided his window for this event and hopefully future events. And one of our hopes is to make greater advantage of the Ganarasca River, which actually I think Port Hope's greatest natural feature. I think you have, or hopefully have, seen and enjoy the mural that was put up during our Steamroller Festival. We would, working with Parks and Rec and Municipality, like to create more permanent installations along the river to complement what the Municipality is trying to do there. I'm going to ask if there's any questions.
Mayor, I do apologize. And then Councilor Plett.
Well, it's not a question, it's a comment. The two events that you've done to date have blown, I think, all of us away, not only with the crowds that have attended the event, but the sort of the aftermath of it. People are still talking about it. You know, and from my point of view, I would be very supportive of the 20,000 that you have requested, because you're now sort of, as you said, it's like go big or go home kind of thing. I think we're at the point now that your organization has got some things that are exciting, have historically been exciting the last 2 years. I think there's incredible potential. So at this point in time, I would put a motion on the floor that we provide the $20,000 as requested.
Further discussion? Councilor Lee? Oh, sorry, Councilor Plutnik was first.
Just the same thing. The deputy mayor said a lot of statements. You guys have done some great work over the last couple of years. You've just, you know, your whole things have gone up and up and up and up every year. You've done bigger and better things. The steamroller was just fantastic. With all these prints and getting the community involved in all these things, the people that have been supporting it, you've really, really taken it from a small group of people starting an idea, and it's really got bigger and bigger. And I think moving the little station from the harbor down the Lentz Lane would be fantastic for you and the community as a whole. So again, with the deputy mayor, I would also, like I said, I'm seconding the $20,000, and hopefully this really gets you guys really, really going. And congratulations to you and all the group for the great work you've done.
Thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Councilor Plutnik?
I think also the critical mass has done a great job. I'm just running down through your numbers here. It is, I mean, you've brought a new and interesting methodology to this town that hasn't been done in a long time, which I really like. And I think it's enjoyed by a lot of people, and I think it's slowly starting to filter out outside of the town of what it is. When I look at the numbers, my only concern is that, I mean, in the 2017 projected year, your displays and construction material comes to $8,200, and I take a look at those fees. Well, in 2018 budget, you're looking for $32,000 in displays and construction fees. I'm assuming that's the projects themselves. But now we're looking at $101,000 in administrative costs, so $20,000 in artist and curator fees, $50,000 and $55,000 for accounting and legal, $12,500 for advertising. I mean, those costs are disproportionate to what you've been doing in the past, and that kind of concerns me that that's a big jump.
I understand.
You know, you've gone from 40% to 70% kind of thing for costs for doing an operation. And yes, you've gone up dramatically, but so the costs have outdistanced in essence, would be your revenue.
Good point. If we take advertising promotions and website, which I think you're probably including with the administrative.
Yeah, anything to do with running, promoting the physical.
Understood. That's how we're going to grow it outside of Port Hope and bring people into Port Hope. Biggest chunk of that is website and social media. Is building that and having people working on social media all the time around our events and just on a day-to-day basis, bringing the people into Port Hope to spend their money, hopefully. I do not expect, for instance, a website will reappear. That's a rebuild. The staffing is, as we need project people to work on these things with us. Either the project manager, although as volunteers, we'll try to take most of that on board. But we also just need hands.
Yeah, no,
it is big, Robert.
The accounting and legal fees is $55,000.
No, but it's not accounting and legal.
It says accounting and legal 2018 change category to admin staff.
That's correct.
Yeah, so it's admin staff to do your accounting.
No, the accounting and legal, we have people on our board that fulfill those responsibilities.
So what's the $55,000 for?
It's for people working with us.
The $55,000 is for two part-time positions, one as a curator to push the artistic programming.
Could you please identify yourself?
Sorry, I'm Debbie Beattie, Director of Critical Mass. The $55,000 is for two part-time positions, one as a program manager to run the programming for the space. The other is a curator's position, who is more in charge with the choosing of the artists and the artistic programming for the year. The other is coordination. And the $55,000 really is reliant on receiving the Trillium Seed Grant, which is based on the Little Train Station project. If we don't receive that grant, then that $55,000 is something that we will do, again, through volunteer work and committees. We have a curatorial committee. We have myself for project coordination. But we're hoping that Trillium grant will come through, because this is a very exciting project.
So the artist and curator fees would literally be added to together would be really your comp-
complement of people to run the program?
Yeah.
So $25,000.
Right. And we do have legal and accounting board members, so that's still...
Yeah, no, I was just looking at the... I mean, your operation costs went...
Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But there is a seed grant with Trillium Foundation, which kind of it's a one-time just to kind of kickstart this exciting opportunity for us to have some more space.
And then Councilor Hickey?
I know somebody sitting off to my right whose initials are Brian Gilmer, who under your office supply, I'm only setting this up so you know it's coming in your direction, friend. Under office supplies, you make reference to desk chair files. I think that if you talk to Brian, you'll be able to get those free of charge because we have a number of them sitting at 5 Mill Street, and I know he is very desperate to get rid of these things. So I think if you touch base with him, he would be delighted to show you where they are.
I'd be loved to take both your hands.
Yes.
Sir Hickey and Councilor Fletcher?
I just want to kind of go back very shortly after we got elected. Councilor Fletcher and I met with Orlais Collins. If you remember, we went to her house. And she was basically talking about this venue. At that point in time, we didn't have a forum or a mobilization or a methodology for the artistic community within Port Hope. So this is a growing representation of that. And so as you've succeeded over the past couple of years, and as you're growing, this will be, as I see it, an increasingly productive cultural representation for the community. So I applaud what you've been able to do in a very short period of time, and the fact that you're able to coalesce something was more or less gelatin 5 years ago and has become maybe a critical mass, but a solid mass. So both are good, so thank you very much.
Councilor Fletcher. And Mayor Sanderson.
Thank you. I've attended some of the events. I think it's great. I think what you're missing in your revenue stream, though, is the fact that you are going to be having a fundraiser, I understand, fairly soon, that will be auctioning off all of the print screens that were done down at the river for the silk print screens. So I know you can't predict how much money you're going to get from that, but I know a few people who are interested in a few of those pieces.
And,
yes, thank you. So I think it's laudable. I think it's a great organization. I think Port Hope seems to be getting a bit of an artistic culture, and that's fantastic. Changing from, it's certainly an area we're moving to with some of these events, which is great. However, I think it's a big leap to 20,000 this year, because I think you've got some revenue coming in that will probably cover some of those costs. So I would support going to 10 and moving it up a bit more incrementally, notwithstanding that, you know, you've got some big projects coming up. There are a lot of people who have gotten behind this in the community, and there's a certain amount of fundraising, I think, that's been done. That's very good. So, but on balance, I think it's a great organization, and I do very much support it.
Thank you.
Mayor Sanderson.
Thanks for coming in and having this dialogue. I think this is an important component of the community, and I've sort of been chatting with you folks since it started. And it brings an element that we don't have, right? And it does expand the artistic community. The areas I like in your comment is that you're going to get into projects that have residual impacts on the community, such as the murals and what have you. Where some of the projects, if we go to our criteria, what does it bring to the community? If it doesn't have some permanent ability for the community to, you know, have an investment, then I think the value is diminished. So it seems to me, and maybe you can clarify, that the focus of the group, because we know that the Ganarasca River is a primary asset that we're trying to develop and are doing so thanks to many of the programs, and if you're going to participate in that, to maintain the creativity that you're bringing to the community. But like Slide Street is a great event, but it was one day, effectively, and it delivered no value, in my opinion. I mean, it was a lot of fun, but it didn't deliver value to the community. And I think that going forward, critical mass has to be, in my opinion, one of those things that helps the community expand its artistic profile, not into just, you know, art and painting, but into the creative area. And I think we're all very supportive of it, but I concur with Councillor Bletcher. It's a big leap, right? There are some revenue opportunities. I mean, I love the stuff that was done. And then combining your event with other events that have people here, I think, you know, it's symbiotic in my opinion. Right? So if you could just clarify the direction Critical Mass hopes to go to, so I can have a better understanding of the kind of residual value that will be delivered. If you look at, you know, Chemainus in British Columbia, they were going down the tubes as a community. They had artists come in and they did murals on all their buildings. That's what people go there for now, and now they're viable. So I'd like to see Critical Mass define the contribution to the municipality that ties into our strategic goals.
Your point is well taken. There is more than one stream. I think we believe we need events to get people's attention, to bring people into the municipality today, but we do need to leave a legacy. And we don't want to own these. We want to leave them for the municipality. And the river is key. We had a strategic session in April where we talked about our objectives, and everything focused around the river, frankly. We don't have the waterfront that Coburg does, but we do have the river, which I think is a much greater advantage. And but the river is what attracts people, whether it be for fishing, whether it be for the history, whether it just be to wander along. And I know the municipalities made a significant investment in the past year in terms of lighting, pathways, etc. And now if we can help develop that with the municipality, at the same time as having events, we do want to leave a legacy, and the little station will do that as well. It provides a center in the center of town that we can use to help draw people to the municipality.
Thank you. Okay, we have a motion on the floor for $20,000. I'm going to ask for a show of hands on this one. All those in favor? Defeated. Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah. One, two, three. So, would somebody like to make a counter motion? Councilor Bletcher?
I'll put a motion on the floor to support Critical Mass for $10,000.
Can I get a seconder? Seconded by Councilor Plutnik. Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Is it the want of everybody to take a brief break for 10 minutes? Sorry for our audience to hold this up, but nature calls.